Strange things are afoot here in front of this tidewater glacier in Svalbard, Norway. While doing research on this glacier system in the summer of 2021, we noticed an unusual concentration of birds in front of this part of the glacier. On some days, there were thousands of seabirds swirling around in front of this glacier. There was quite a variety of species, kittiwakes, fulmars, terns, and gulls, to name a few. What could cause this behavior? We noticed that the birds were concentrated in a very few locations like this, right up next to the glacier. Given the constant risk of falling ice, this seems like a pretty hazardous place to hang out. Could this be a mating ritual, a feeding frenzy, some sort of community bonding activity? What is so special about this location? In order to find out, let's investigate more closely. There are a few interesting things to note in this scene. First, notice the color of the water. It's incredibly brown in front of this part of the glacier. In fact, if you were to put your hand in the water, you wouldn't be able to see the tips of your fingers. Second, notice that the glacier face here has a cave-like appearance. In fact, there are several places in this glacier system where we see these congregations of birds. In each one, the cave-like feature is there. In this one, the glacier appears to have been carved out even more. Third, if we look closely, we might see that the level of the water is a bit higher than the surrounding. And when we look from above, we can see that the water is moving away from the glacier. In places like this, the water may actually be bubbling and churning as it moves away. If the water is bubbling up at this location, where could that water be coming from? Each of these places, where there is a concentration of birds, and where we see these glacial cave features, is likely a location where a subglacial stream is flowing down under the glacier until it hits the ocean. Glaciers are moving rivers of solid ice, but they also contain a significant amount of liquid water, particularly in the summer when the air temperature may be above freezing. You can see water pooling on top of some of the glaciers, like we see quite a bit of on top of the Kronebreen and Kongsvegen glaciers that we were studying. Much of this water will make its way down through the glacier, and in many cases right down to the bottom of the glacier through channels called moulins. Some of these channels will join together, forming high-pressure subglacial streams. When these streams finally exit the glacier at the glacier face, they exit in what are called upwelling plumes. Because the water in ice is freshwater, which is less dense than the salty ocean water, when the water from the subglacial stream hits the ocean water, the freshwater rises quickly to the top of the water column. The water in the subglacial stream is under enormous pressure, so it comes out with tremendous force. The fast, vertically moving water carves out ice on the face of the glacier, leaving behind vertical grooves called runnels. As the water carves these runnels out, they erode the glacier face to the point where the cave feature appears. The brown color comes from fine-grained glacial sediment eroded by the glacier and carried down to the ocean by the fast-moving subglacial stream. The fast upward motion of the stream carries the sediment to the top of the ocean water when it hits the front of the glacier face. Because the water is so murky, it's impossible to see directly what is happening below the water surface. However, geologist Rico Normitz took sonar images of the glacier face and discovered runnels along the glacier face in exactly the places where we expect a subglacial stream to be exiting the glacier. We can also get clues about subglacial streams by looking at recently formed icebergs. As icebergs calve off the glacier face, they rarely stay upright. Depending on the size and shape of the glacier, they may show the side or even the bottom of the glacier at the top of the iceberg. An iceberg which broke off from a part of the glacier face where the upwelling plumes existed will reveal the runnels created by the upward carving motion of the freshwater stream exiting under the glacier. The outward flow of water from the upwelling plumes is also visible on the water surface. We can see that even at times when the fjord is chock full of ice, the regions in front of the upwelling plumes remain relatively ice-free. The fast-moving current of fresh water moves above the salt water and outward, away from the glacier. This then pushes away small icebergs. Oh yeah, so what about the birds, the phenomenon which began our investigation into the upwelling plume areas in the first place? As the water discharges and moves rapidly upward, this freshwater intrudes into the saltwater habitats of various krill, copepods, and other tiny animals that the birds feed upon. This rapid change in salinity creates what is known as osmotic shock, immobilizing these critters and sending them to the surface. So now our birds can engage in a sort of all-you-can-eat buffet of osmotically shocked critters. In this video clip of a tidewater glacier that has retreated onto land, you can see a subglacial stream pouring out from the interface between the ice and rock. What is missing, of course, are most of the birds. For sure, fresh water is flowing into the ocean, but it enters the surface water and does not hit the tiny organisms the birds depend on for food, so they are not osmotically shocked. As glaciers retreat, eventually these tidewater glaciers with these rich and fascinating little ecosystems will be permanently altered. Gone will be the upwelling plumes with their bird-feeding buffets. How will that affect the population of birds who feed on the stunned zooplankton, or even the predatory birds and mammals who might feed on these birds? This is just one example of the breathtakingly beautiful features of the glacial landscape that will be irreversibly changed if we allow our atmosphere to heat up by our continued emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases. Well, we've solved the mystery of the birds at the upwelling plumes, but hopefully we can use our scientific skills to tackle the more important problem of climate change. Each of us needs to do our part to take action, stay informed, and to support leaders who will pursue policies to mitigate the effects of a warming climate. Then, hopefully, amazing ecosystems like those at glacial upwelling plumes will continue to exist far into the future.